Harper One and Harper Audio present The Dreaming Path. Indigenous ideas to help us change the world. By Paul Callaghan with Uncle Paul Gordon. Read by Luke Carroll and Gregory J. Fryer. While this book is intended as a general information resource and all care has been taken in compiling the contents, it does not take account of individual circumstances and is not in any way intended as a substitute for professional medical or psychological advice, diagnosis, or treatment. It is essential that you always seek advice from a qualified health professional if you suspect you have a health problem. The author and publisher disclaim any liability in connection with the use or reliance on the information contained in this book. The information in this book is published in good faith and for general information purposes only. Although the author and publisher believe at the time of going to press that the information is correct, they do not assume and hereby disclaim any liability to any party for any loss, damage, or disruption caused by errors or omissions, whether they result from negligence, accident, or any other cause. Some passages in this book include knowledge and cultural expressions of Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander peoples. This knowledge comes from country and its people and has been handed down through the generations. It is Indigenous cultural and intellectual property, ICIP, that belongs communally to First Peoples who continue to practice their culture. First Peoples have cultural protocols about how their ICIP can be shared and used, and the unauthorized use, adaptation, and publication of ICIP without the free prior informed consent of First Peoples is a breach of ICIP protocols. Content warning. This book addresses themes of depression, trauma, and suicide. To those who are ready to shed their cloak of grey and dance in colour. To my wife Alison, who has taught me so many things. To those who have come before me. I hope I have honoured your footsteps. The message. The big sky slumbered in its enormity. The stars looked down on the ancient sands with infinite memories of what had been. The orange of small flames pierced the darkness. By the firelight I sat, hypnotized by the profound stillness. The crackle and fizz of the embers amplified the quiet as wisps of smoke began to take shape. The old spirit looked at me with eyes of wisdom, love, and sadness. Why are you all so busy but doing so little? Why do you try so hard to get things you don't really need? Why do you see happiness as such a hard thing to achieve? Why can't you be content with what you have been given? What you really need is all around you, but you don't see it. You have all lost your way. You have forgotten who you are. You are not living your truth. You still have time to remember. You need to remember. You need to reconnect. If you don't remember, if you don't reconnect, you will have failed us, and things that are important will be gone. We will be gone. Everything will be gone. And lost. Forever. Preface. We, the authors of this book, pay our respects to and acknowledge all Indigenous peoples of this earth, past, present, and future. As Aboriginal people from the lands now called Australia, we honour the many traditional Aboriginal nations within Australia. We pay our respects to our Aboriginal elders across Australia and acknowledge their wisdom and guidance. We also acknowledge the ancestral animals that travelled country long before we came to be, creating the rivers, mountains, and other landscapes before resting in the land itself. There are sacred places of respect and remembrance throughout Australia that connect us all. We have written this book with love and with a desire to share appropriate knowledge with all who will listen. We do this with the belief that Indigenous cultures around the globe, including Australian Aboriginal culture, have the power to provide significant healing to the world. Special care has been taken to ensure that the old people would consider the knowledge we share appropriate to share with the general public. We respect the special nature of Aboriginal cultural and spiritual knowledge and have gone to great lengths to ensure we do not disclose any information that might be considered inappropriate. We acknowledge we can only speak from our perspective and cannot speak on behalf of any other Aboriginal peoples or groups. Any resemblance in information contained in this book to that of other Aboriginal nations or communities is unintentional, but somewhat unavoidable, given the relationships that have been sustained and stories that have been shared across this vast land since the beginning. It is our hope that if we share our knowledge, thoughts, and experiences, the reader will be inspired to seek cultural knowledge, insight, and context locally from the elders and knowledge owners of the many Indigenous nations that have cared for country and continue to care for country across the world. The stories we share have been created to demonstrate the beauty and wisdom of our culture. Most are new, but some are our interpretation of old stories that have been passed on to us. We share these old stories as a sign of respect for those who have shared this wisdom with us. Paul Callaghan and Uncle Paul Gordon.
Being Aboriginal is not the colour of your skin, but your connection and responsibility to country and all things in nature. It is about your connection to trees, fish, birds, rivers, rocks, and stars. It isn't about how you look. It isn't even about your bloodlines. It is about something unseen, deep inside you. Uncle Paul Gordon.
Introduction. In Aboriginal spirituality, everything is conceived. All things become pregnant. Trees, plants, insects, birds, fish, reptiles, mammals, rocks, and eventually give birth. The birth of this book is the result of 60,000 years of gestation. It contains knowledge and story that have been passed on for more than 1,800 generations. Some people might be thinking, so? What use would a book based on a different culture from a different world be to me as I try to balance the demands of work, paying the bills, and doing my best to be a good person? To answer that question, I would like to ask you to let go of the present for just a moment. I would like to ask you to imagine a world with no war, no crime, no homelessness, no hunger, and no poverty. A world where every person has all they need to live a long life of fulfillment and well-being. A world with many languages, but where there is no word for hate, because hate does not exist. You can let go of imagining now and come back to the present. Do you think the kind of world described above can really exist? Most people would say no. They would say that history shows us human beings, by nature, doing inhuman things to each other. They would say that over many thousands of years, we have demonstrated we are incapable of uniting in a loving and caring way. I disagree. The utopia described above was how Aboriginal people lived for a very, very long time. Yes, there were instances of disagreement and anger, but as you read this book, you will gain an understanding of the systems, rules, and obligations in traditional Aboriginal society that created a way of life the analytical mind finds hard to accept. The traditional Aboriginal world functioned in a different time, but I'm going to show you how traditional values, ways of thinking, and practices are just as applicable now, perhaps even more so. The world today has many things that give us joy and inspiration. Sunsets and sunrises, rainbows, snow-covered mountains, a child's laughter, hot water, chocolate, and the smell of coffee are things that lift my spirits and immerse me in bliss for a moment or two. And the ability to connect with a loved one who lives far away by phone, video link, plane or vehicle is a remarkable testimony to the benefits of scientific and technological advancement. But as I reflect on everything around me, although I know everyone is trying their hardest to do their best, I see too many faces lined with anxiety and stress. I see too few faces that emanate inner peace or contentment. I see too many people who appear to be going around in circles. For me, the world is a magical place where I can see, hear, touch, taste, and smell an abundance of treasures, even when I am having one of those tough days when nothing seems to go right. I haven't always had this outlook. Once upon a time, mine was one of those faces etched with determination but lacking in luster. For more than 60 years, I have been privileged to walk this earth. I have been through many of the peaks and troughs of life that we all must face. Like most people my age, I have navigated family grief, personal illness, paying bills, raising a family, and pursuing a career while also trying to be a good son, brother, husband, father, friend, and colleague. My navigation process before culture was much more difficult than post-culture. The many things Aboriginal culture has given me have enabled me to achieve a state of mind, body, and spirit wellness I never thought possible. This book provides numerous insights and messages that can help you do the same. The privilege of writing this book with Paul Gordon, Uncle Paul, a person of considerable insight, generosity, and patience, much needed with a protege like me, is something I could not possibly have imagined years ago when I looked into the mirror. This book will reawaken your appreciation of the power of story. The sharing of story is a cornerstone of Aboriginal culture. Story gives us time to slow down. Story connects us. Story teaches us. But before Uncle Paul and I share with you the wisdom of the ancient ones, I would like to share with you the story of how I was given access to the knowledge of the world's oldest living culture. Was it an accident or was it destiny? You can make up your own mind as you read on. What I do know is that this learning changed my life. It possibly saved my life. It is knowledge that is so simple to understand and yet so profound in its application. And it is here for all of us to consider, embrace, and live if we are ready for the responsibilities that come with it. When I was 34 years old, I was the Great Western success story. I had 3 degrees, 2 jobs, 3 kids, 2 cars, a house, and was married to the love of my life. I was living the dream. Despite all of this, on the day of my 35th birthday, I sat on some steps at my workplace and cried. The tears continued for many months. Darkness, anxiety, and fear saturated my soul. The happy-go-lucky, always busy, indestructible mask of bravado I had worn for so long cracked and then fell apart, leaving me feeling naked, vulnerable, and exposed. The psychiatrist diagnosed me with major depression and anxiety disorder. I went and researched these sinister words. and the darkness went several shades darker. Reading about depression made me more depressed. I was told there was no cure and that my condition would be a permanent one. I could learn to manage it best. One day I sat by the water's edge thinking, this is the moment to end it. The thought of ending my life was a compelling one. I saw it as the best way to free my family from the burden of having to care for someone with a permanent mental illness. But then a random thought came to me that betrayed my plan. Maybe I don't need to believe the labels. Maybe I can learn from this experience and prove the experts wrong. And so started the process of healing. When I started to look deep inside, I found there were missing pieces, undefined and intangible, dark spaces in my spirit that moved and hid whenever my gaze turned toward them. I was searching for personal meaning, something to fill a void that no amount of career, monetary, or other external success could fill. I read books, lots of books. Books on the various world spiritualities, self-help books, books on mental health, books on brain physiology, books on happiness, books on depression. I tapped into other people, alternative healers, psychologists and psychiatrists, and in men's groups and meditation groups. I practiced yoga, exercised a lot, created artworks, enjoyed my guitar, and learned all sorts of ways to breathe. The missing pieces were slowly becoming more defined when something serendipitous happened. I was invited to go bush and learn about my culture. This invitation had come as a major surprise. I had always felt proud of my Aboriginal heritage, but had been told that traditional culture was long gone. Now here I was, in the bush, about to be given my first insight into our old ways. The first thing I was shown was the smoking ceremony, and the importance of smoking yourself before going onto a site was explained.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.